Hey, what's up? This is Level With Me. This is my show where I play games and talk about what I think is going on in the level design with them. It's been a long time. I think the last episode was like a month ago or something. I went on vacation and stuff. Sorry. Let's get back into BioShock and see what's going on here. I think I'm on that save. Okay, so we just finished this big chapter called Smuggler's Hideout, and we saw like a submarine explode and stuff. Now we are going to, I guess, go on to the next level called Arcadia. And Arcadia, I think, is probably, most people would say, maybe the like first or second best part of BioShock. It's kind of this cool section where you get to oh look, all the Bibles and Jesus is in there. It's kind of a cool section with like a lot of like cool like layouts and a lot of different places to go and stuff. Very non-linear and stuff, so a lot of people usually like it. You came to rob what you could never build. A hub gaping at the gates of Rome. Even the air you breathe is sponged from my account. Well, so the conceit of this chapter is that this is like where all the air in the city of Rapture, this underwater city, comes from. So they have all these plants everywhere, and as we know, plants produce oxygen, right? A lot of this chapter will kind of revolve around these plants, and I don't know, video games usually like foliage a lot, I find. Foliage kind of produces like a totally different variety of shapes for you to put in your games. You know, like notice like man-made architectures, usually like very like angular, usually not green. So green foliage and trees and stuff are usually like a really nice opportunity to like add color to your games. There's the skybox outside. If you've been watching previous episodes, you'll know that I like skyboxes. Although I'm actually not really feeling this skybox that much, sorry. Let's activate some cheats and try to go outside. Oh wait, why won't that let me go outside? Okay, there we go. Yeah, I activate some cheats, you can see how this skybox scene is structured. Here we can see, oh, fishies, that's nice. Here we can see like all these cables and stuff everywhere. I think I'm not really feeling these cables. I think they're kind of like too thick. Like if you compare the thickness of these cables to like the rest of the scaling of these buildings, these cables are like really, really huge. Also, if they were like underwater cables, wouldn't they be kind of like floating and like undulating and stuff? So I don't really like how static these cables are, and I don't like how thick they are. It's also just kind of too many of them. It's kind of hard for me to know or read what exactly this skybox scene is trying to tell me about Rapture. Rapture has a lot of power cables, I guess that's the main thing, or they're like more like floating like buoy kind of things, I guess, except they're not really floating because they're staying still and they're static. But I guess I do like these random like little bubble vents. We see these a lot throughout the game. One thing that I've liked in BioShock in this playthrough is all these random little like particle effects, and this is in 2007. This is kind of an era of game graphics technology where People are starting to like normal map and add shading to particles. So you can notice based on the direction I'm looking at these particles, they're shaded very differently. That's what kind of gives them this like nice sense of depth to them. And then they look particularly nice, I think, when you are inside here. But anyway, not a huge fan of this skybox, and these buildings just look kind of like kind of random and stuff. But again, another major theme of my show, if you've been watching before, is that we should always try to think about like critiquing from one designer's perspective to another is one thing, but we should always try to keep in mind the player's actual like phenomenology, their actual experience of walking through this space. And what most players experience of walking through this space is they'll walk forward, they'll look there, okay, those are some windows, is there any treasure down here? No, okay, I'll go this way now, right? Most players would spend a few seconds looking at this. Anyway, let's keep going. Let's go over. Is this a shovel? Can I pick up the shovel? No. There's some fire. Oh, the distortion is kind of wacky on that one. Fake door. Okay, let's go over here. Oh, sorry, I have to move the BioShock window a little bit. Okay, there we go. Okay. Oh, really nice scene. This scene is, this whole chapter, I believe. I don't know if he's, here, JP LeBreton. He also has a really great, Twitch show on Wednesdays called WoD Wednesdays, where he plays through random Doom levels. That's really cool. He also has a cool demake of this Arcadia level. In the chat, people are telling me to come back here and set this torch on fire. Okay, I don't know what that will do. Oh my god. Oh yeah, it's like a weird Zelda puzzle. What? That's really weird. Nothing else in the game does that. But you know, that's like a cool bonus puzzle, I guess. That's so weird. Okay. What's in here? Oh, a bunch of treasure. I don't know who's saying that. Do 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 do. Yeah, totally. Zelda puzzle. So that's a fun little trick, huh? I never knew about that. Cool. Let's keep going around here. Ooh, some shotguns hidden under a rock. That's kind of a weird place to hide a shotgun. Christ, is somebody there? That's kind of weird. But what was I saying? Oh yeah, JP, the main level designer on this chapter, designed a pretty cool demake in the Doom engine of this level. So you should totally check that out. Oh, more ghosts and stuff. Someone's shouting for help, but I don't know where they're coming from. Ooh, a lot of ghosts everywhere. Oh. Oh, sugar. I'm sliced up in ways you never dreamed of. Oh, and in the chat, people are posting links to JP's Twitch channel as well as the Arcadia demake. So totally check that out in the chat if you have a chance. I really like, so this is kind of like another common video gamey thing. You know, whenever you have plants, you always have to have like nice rocks and stuff. And we've talked about this in previous episodes of Level With Me where, rocks are kind of this like video game art trope. If you go to Polycount, which is the most popular, 3D game art forum, there's a thread that's like 50 pages long of just people posting their rocks over and over. Getting their rocks off, so to speak.
They're everywhere!
Oh. Who's everywhere? Oh. Is this a trap or something? Oh, cool. And then there's shadows of the... So I think this is our introduction to a new monster called a Houdini Splicer, I believe? The ones that can teleport around. So it's supposed to be kind of like creepy and eerie because this is like an enemy introduction. We don't really know what's going on here. Ooh, a grenade launcher. Anything else? Should I be like... Oh, we can't burn the plants away? Oh well. I guess it would be too depressing if you could burn all the plants away. Do I go...
Hey, over here!
I don't think this guy actually needs my help. It's almost like if you didn't know this is a BioShock game, like if you looked at like this picture, you'd think you're in like Elder Scrolls or like Morrowind or something. So strange. Oh, it's a mask. Oh my god, what's happening?
Hello.
Oh, that's creepy. Oh, that's like an echo of an earlier encounter in the medical pavilion when someone kind of comes up behind you. Ooh, and scary laughter. Well, I guess we'll just keep going. No sense in dwelling on it. In the chat, someone's asking what I meant by player phenomenology. So by phenomenology, I mean like paying attention to like... just like what you're seeing and experiencing and kind of like feeling. And that's like maybe a misuse of the phrase phenomenology. Phenomenology is like an intense school of thought and philosophy that you should totally Google and learn more about. But I'm kind of using it to kind of, as a, I guess this catch-all term for what I mean to be like, just pay attention to, like, imagine what the player's thinking, kind of, and experiencing, is kind of what I mean by that. What else am I doing here? Okay. Oh, should I go here? No, I don't need to go there. Let's go over here. Oh, weird tiling right here. Could have put, like, a little, like, machine... Greeble right here to cover that up. Oh well. I think it's just particularly glaring in this instance because when we walk through here and I turn right, it's like right in my field of view. So that's where it's kind of a little bit annoying. I think I will put like, yeah, some kind of like fuse box or something right here, especially since it's lit prominently by this thing too. Oh, ow, who's shooting? Oh, that guy. Oh, I kind of like how it's this little trap of oil that gets set around you. That's interesting. But notice, when you walk in through here, JP is kind of setting you up where to go and stuff already, because here we have a light source here, and then we have a light source here. So that lighting helps like orient us and tell us the trajectory of where we're supposed to go. And then lastly, there's an enemy right here, so of course you have to put a light source right here. Otherwise, I wouldn't even be able to see that guy who was standing there and shooting at me. And then lastly, when we go here and we're shooting at this guy, this ends up entering our field of view as well. So... we end up seeing this, and we end up remembering this like very distinctive sign that says Arcadia Glens. And then this has not one, but two different lampposts there. So those two lampposts help signify that this will be a very important thing for us to pay attention to later. Let's keep going here. Oh, should I check his body for stuff? But did this guy not see me? Huh, that was weird. Wolf thought he would have seen me. Oh well. Oh man, I love that water. Look at that water bump map. Clearly animated because it's kind of like jittery and stuff, but I like it. It's nice. Okay, what else are we doing here? Oh, we've learned in previous chapters that when you see one of these broken sparking switches, you should switch to your electricity bolt, and that will open it up. Did I get everything? Okay. Oh, what's that? Okay, I guess I'll hack this. And then if you're coming into this playthrough, you should know that I generally don't play the hacking mini game just for your convenience. Because it's just easier to just always buy things out. Okay, so this room's kind of interesting. I like that there's kind of this like sprinkler theme going on right here. Actually really nice particle effect on that too. Like, it looks really nice. It holds up for some effects you would expect from like 2007. Although it holds up mostly because that's a flat billboard. If you walk underneath and look up, you can see that that's actually just like a flat vertical billboard card. But still, looks nice, I think. And most people wouldn't stand directly underneath the sprinkler and look up. So I guess it's worth it in that sense. What else? I like the theming around a grow house. One thing that's weird is that there's all these sprinklers on the roof, but then no plant boxes underneath. It's weird that all the plants are moved over here where they actually don't get the benefit of a roof sprinkler. But I imagine maybe this room was previously cluttered in like a previous draft, and then enemies had a really hard time with it. So maybe they had to clear out the room a lot more so that the AI would be a little bit smarter here. And generally, you'll find this is the case with a lot of first-person games. You know, shooting enemies just don't really do well in cramped spaces. So usually, you usually want to like err on the side of more open spaces with sparse cover in between, like these big wooden columns. Look at how chunky this big wooden column is. And you know, that's really the only cover in this entire room, right? But it lets you do this kind of fun gameplay when you put cover in the middle like this. You get to do this kind of ring around the rosy kind of stuff. That's especially prevalent in, you know, games like Doom and stuff, where you're constantly circle strafing people. In BioShock, you're not doing that so much, but here, there's clearly a sense of, like, combat and what's supposed to happen here. Ooh, bags of manure, fresh as can be. This is a nice bag of manure. I like the details on this. Really nice normal map. Look at those creases. Did I get everything here? Okay, let's walk over here. Oh, and then there's tripwire traps here. How do you undo these traps? Am I doing this right? Maybe I should just trigger the trap. I don't really care. One thing I don't really like about this chapter is they have these... Oh, is someone coming in here? One thing I don't like about this is these crawlspace doors. They kind of blend in with the scenery a lot. Like, the rest of this chapter kind of takes great pains to always kind of like highlight things. And then you have these crawlspace doors that don't really pop out to you. That are kind of these... just like random things that almost look like background decoration. I feel like most games would have made this like bright red or something, or would have maybe made it just much bigger and like chunkier. I'm not gonna bother hacking the safe. Oh my god, is that dead cat? What the hell? Oh my god, what the hell? Oh, we're back where we were. Okay, so I guess that was just like a little side area. Oh, I know, this is where I came from. Where am I supposed to go now? Oh, I know, that's where I came from. Okay, maybe I was supposed to go down there. One thing I do like about this area is that it really feels like a deathmatch level in some sense. Because there's just so many, like, level over level kind of areas you can, like, walk around in and stuff. And there's just so many entrances and exits. Like, I have a feeling if you just, like, ran this level in deathmatch mode, it would actually play okay, because you have all these different little rooms and nooks, and nothing is really a dead end. So here I think you see some of JP's roots here showing through. Oh, I think this is the way I'm supposed to go.
Saturnine, run! Run!
Oh, can I crawl through here? No, I guess that's just blocked. Okay, I'll go back this way.
They're coming!
This is our place! Ours!
Oh my god, she just exploded! Oh, should I invent something? It's telling me to. Okay, I invented that. Notice we haven't encountered any of the main BioShock enemies, like the Big Daddy and Little Sister pairings. That's because this is kind of our first run of the level, so... Oh, speaking of which... The level designer kind of wants us to encounter these little scenes and get a sense of how the level is constructed before we go ahead and... Does he need any help? Before we go ahead and do these mini little boss fights. Here, let me help. There we go. Okay, we'll go in here. What's in here? Oh, another U-Invent? That's kind of weird, because we just saw another U-Invent machine nearby. Oh well. Oh, here's the Arcadia Glen sign we saw before. And again, just notice how, like, interconnected all this is, right? You have rooms over here, rooms here. We have a lower level down there that we might visit later. Oh. What else is over here? Oh, a lot more signs and stuff. Oh, oops. Oh, too late. Oh. Well, let's wait for all this to settle down a little. And once this settles down, let's look around this room. Oh my god, I said let's look around this room. Oh, okay, there we go. So, this is kind of an interesting room. Yes, I am playing on easy. That's why the Big Daddy fights are actually not that hard or anything. I really like this room, because this room is kind of a nice change of pace. Notice how we enter from this big room, go into this small kind of transition area where it's like a narrow hallway, and then we come out into this bigger room, and then this bigger room feels bigger because we were just in this smaller space. So that contrast is kind of nice. I also like how there's just so many more plants right here, and really it's the same assets we've been seeing throughout like the rest of this chapter, but when you just position these assets and arrange them in a different way, it feels like this room is about something different, like a lot more ivy than usual. So I like how this room feels kind of more diverse and stuff, even though it's kind of the same tile set and props we've been seeing for the past few minutes. This is saying... Oh, going the wrong way? Where am I supposed to be going? Oh, I got right. Very sneaky. I think I'm supposed to go here, according to the arrow at the top of my screen.
On the surface, I once bought a forest. The parasites claimed that the land belonged to God.
Do I really?
That I establish a public park there.
Okay, let's hack this one.
So the rebels can stand slack-jawed under the...
Oh no, I don't have enough money to buy it out. Okay.
Congress moved to nationalize my forest.
Apologies.
I burnt it to the ground.
But this will come in handy later. Jesus Christ. Okay. Oh, I don't think I have the right parts to do this. Oh well. Oh well, I guess we just lost. Now, I really like this room, because of the height variation here. Like, notice how, most of the rooms we've been walking through are like relatively flat, right? And that's just what's easier to build inside a level editor. Always, you know, flat, square, 90 degree angles like this. And then you come into this room and there's just this nice bumpy terrain right here. I don't know how easy or hard that was to do in the Unreal Engine 2, but you know, this is a really nicely done terrain, I feel like. You know, it feels like nice and bumpy, appropriately like natural. And then there's like all these trees here to kind of give you a sense of this forest space. A nice call with all this volumetric light. This chapter in general has been making a lot of use of this volumetric light, which is kind of giving, which kind of helps you give that forest vibe, you know, with all the light shining through the trees. So I think that was a good call. Okay, what else am I doing here? I like this water. I like... Well, it looks a little silly when the water just screams like that, but good thought though. Oh. And there's all this green gas coming through, so, it looks like... Oh no, all the trees are dead. Nice transition.
You defile this place.
Oh god.
An okay sort, but not above doing a dirty job for a dollar. If she's still kicking around, I'm sure she's gonna want to save her trees.
Oh.
After all, she planted the damn thing.
Okay, so we have to save the trees. Got it.
All bulkhead doors are now sealed. Thank you.
Damn city built to not let anyone out in the event of this kind of emergency. Either we get those.
Okay, let's go save some trees. I like in games when you have this like kind of like dynamic environment stuff, when you can do something that kind of affects the world in this way. I like that everything transitioned. Although really not that much transitioned, right? It kind of changed the foliage mesh textures, and then it spawned some particle systems. And then that was basically it. Well, maybe some like color correction stuff. They add like green fog everywhere. You know, that's like just three or four things. It's not really a huge change, but it feels like a big change. Okay, just to go through here.
My trees! It wasn't you, was it?
My trees!
No. Ryan. I think I've got a way to save the trees. It's a genetic vector that...
Kind of a one-note character, right? Okay, we get it. You like trees. Ooh. Okay, let's fly out and look at the skybox for a little bit. Man, I like these particles right here. Like, so little. It's just like a suspended particle system. That's just like four or five particles, I think. But still, when you're looking out there from here, it looks really nice. what else is going on here? More of our good friend Bubbles. Oh, I like this. I didn't even notice these. That's kind of cool. Like the trees get their own little base or something. That's nice. Okay, let's go back here. Oh, she's not gonna let us in unless we find a genetic vector. Okay. Oh, this is a big fight. Okay, then I guess we have to go in here. And oh, we were just here. Except all the trees are dead. Oh, that's so sad. One thing I like here is that they kind of set you up to notice this big flaming entryway that you didn't notice before. It's really nice how when we walk here, our line of sight is already set up for this weird grotto we're supposed to go into. Ooh. Am I supposed to pick something up here? Oh. Okay, I got the chlorophyll solution. I guess we have to go over here now. Ooh, I like the water reflection effects on this. Looks nice. It's not really overdoing it too. I like in this scene how when you're standing here, oh, weird sorting, transparency sorting issues. Here you can see there's actually two different water brushes, it looks like. Interesting. But I like how in this scene, we can't really see the ceiling. The ceiling just looks like this dark, flat color. But when you're here, it doesn't really matter that the ceiling is just this dark, flat color. Because there's still enough of the ceiling that's still built out. Specifically these like rock chunks right here, right? Good move on that. It's kind of like very like selective and specific with the decoration and set dressing. So I think that's smart. I think usually what's kind of annoying is when you like feel like you have to like texture and detail every inch of an area, but really you can just focus the player's attention to specific areas and just decorate those and then leave everything else kind of blank, literally. Walk over here.
Oh, your faces are melted! Here's the poison! Kill him!
The poison! Kill the poison!
Crash the parasite!
Oh. God damn it, I'm...
Oh, he ran into his own traps. That's sad. Where are we? Waterfall Grotto. Okay. Oh, I like the design on this sign. Nice. I guess we have to go down there. I guess. Oh, why can't I hack it? Oh, ow. What's going on? Well, I guess I'll just blow it up. Oh, there's a camera right here. Very sneaky. I'm playing very sloppily, by the way. Sorry. I should be a little bit more careful, maybe. Running out of ammo on everything too. Okay, now where's this solution I'm supposed to collect? Oh, a rose. Okay. Guy go. Oh well, whatever. Now one thing I like about this room is that one thing I like about this room is that you kind of get this nice path and trajectory towards through this. There's kind of this like centerpiece with all these roses and gears and waterfalls. But you're kind of like just kind of orbiting around it when you're walking around these pathways. So I kind of liked that there's this kind of orbiting path that let us kind of get a sense of the whole shape of the room and what the room was about. And then we kind of go up and down from there. Oh, and there's actually another exit. Maybe I'll go this way instead. Oh wait, this isn't an exit. Oops. Oh well. Also, nice color contrast. Like, I like how there's a lot of, like, green going on in this scene, and then you have a lot of red from these roses. What is giving off this light source? Why are the roses, like, glowing and stuff? It's not really clear, but it doesn't matter, because it kind of works anyway. It looks like, if I had to say, it looks like there's, like, a spotlight, like, around here, actually pointing down at these roses. The actual light source looks like it's like up here. Which again, does not make sense, really. But video game lighting, we do this all the time. Where's the light source for this? Why is there light right here? Who knows? Who cares? I mean, although that is a little sloppy. I don't know. Maybe I would have put a light source, like a light fixture right here. But you don't want to put too many light fixtures everywhere. Notice that this room actually really carefully balances how many hot spots and light fixtures you're looking at. There's two right here to mark this stairwell. And then there's some lanterns at the bottom that mark various points of interest down here on the ground. But other than that, they kind of limit how many hot spots you're looking at. So maybe that was a smarter choice, actually. Oh, two big daddies in one room. I also kind of like how we're backtracking. I personally kind of like backtracking in games. You know, that's what an open world game is, if you think about it. Or that's what an MMO or an RPG is about, right? Like, I feel like backtracking is like a very specific term that doesn't actually refer to the formal feeling or formal like behavior of actually retracing your steps. I feel like backtracking actually refers to more of like this annoyance you have, right? It's not that players don't like backtracking, it's that they don't like backtracking under certain circumstances, right?
I'm letting you in now. I think I've got just the thing to put the green back in this forest.
Ooh, nice office. Very Brooklyn, right? Look at all this reclaimed wood. These nice industrial pipes. Oh, that'd be nice. What's out there? Oh yeah, those are the trees we were looking at before.
I've got the security system in this joint hacked, so those turrets won't bite. Come on up to my office.
Oh, I like that. That's like some really clever plotting, how like it actually ties into the gameplay systems. That's smart, I think. And then because like it seems like the NPC is like helping us through the gameplay system, it kind of feels like we, you know, I like her more because she actually has this kind of like intervention inside the whole game system. Oh, look at these. Incubator. I kind of like how the environment artist literally wrote the words incubator on this, because otherwise I would have had no idea what these were. But they look cool. They're nice little metal box things, I guess. Another tree inside a tank. People in the chat mentioned, isn't it weird when that tree is gonna grow and kind of like outgrow its little cage? Really, that's more like a tree jail, right? One thing I like about what's going on right now is I'm supposed to be walking this area to reach her office. And what's happening right now is I'm walking through these big areas. There's a minor time pressure for me to actually hurry up and loot everything while I still can. But I'm also looking at all this stuff in all these big areas. And if there's one thing I've learned, it's that big areas mean I'm gonna fight in them, right? Big open areas with cover in the middle mean there's gonna be a fight. So I think what most players will feel as they're walking through this is like, oh no, something's gonna go down here. And it's probably not gonna be good. So it's actually a little bit foreboding and kind of a little bit scary and dangerous and intimidating feeling a little bit. Ominous, even. Oh, pretty plain skybox here. Like, look at that rock. That rock is just a cylinder. But, oh well, maybe no one cares.
Julie, we made a business deal, you and I, did we not? Money changed hands. Let me read to you from the agreement.
So in this game, it's really rare to see humans that aren't infected and humans that aren't like trying to kill you and stuff. So it's always such a weird treat when you get to see this woman gassed to death, I guess, behind a window. Well, I really like this part, where she's written out this code with her last dying breath. The way they did that is something called an alpha cutout gradient. It's a really, really great trick. I recommend you look it up. It's one of my most favorite game art tricks. To get that kind of effect of like the numbers being drawn out. Really nice. But it looks like oh, it's not so bad in here. Central misting control. 9457. Got it. It's no 0451, but you know, it's close enough.
What's the point of being a damn genius if the only ones around to appreciate it are a bunch of spliced up morons? I've cracked the vector, or at least I'm 99% certain I have. I just need a bud of Rosa Gallica to confirm my analysis. Distilled water, a bit of chlorophyll, and enzymes extracted from Apis mellifera. That's right, sweetheart. Honeybee spit.
Oh, multi-part goal. Press M to see all the parts of the goal. Oh my god, so complicated. Okay. So it looks like I have to go to all these different places and then use one of those invention machines, the new gameplay system that they introduced in this chapter. And then once I get all that stuff together, I'll be able to invent a Lazarus vector. But really, I'm not inventing it. Really, I'm just stealing her research, right? Really, I'm more like Watson and Crick stealing the DNA double helix structure, I guess. And then once I invent it, I guess I come back here, and then I can... This thing will be sparkling, and I can use it, and everything will be solved, and then all those trees will bloom again. But I think all that stuff will have to wait for next week, unfortunately, because it's been about an hour, which means our time is up for now. Thanks for hanging out, and thanks for seeing this introduction to the whole Arcadia chapter. Next week, we will try to invent the Lazarus vector and save all the trees. But in the meantime, thanks for watching, and see you next week.